Welcome to Coinology, the podcast. Hey. Welcome to a new episode of Coinology. And I am so honored to be sitting across from none other than Teresa Morcho. Teresa, welcome.
Hello.
Hey. I am so. Look, what do you think about power? What do you think about that song?
Listen, first of all, Kanye has newfound respect for me.
All day.
Like, I know what y'all got to say about my man Kanye, but
who?
Watch
y'all.
You know what I mean?
I love Kanye.
Because, you know, the news had all this to say about his relationship. We all have issues in our relationship.
Mm-hmm.
But when it comes to how he handles business and the just his brilliance, listen.
But let's go back to the relationship piece, right? What Kanye said was, I want to protect the integrity of my children.
Facts.
Right? So I think that his genius is just renowned. And I think the fact that he can stand out and not worry about the noise and go after the magic.
Yes.
Right? And that's one of the reasons why we have you here today. For those who don't know, Teresa Morcho is a beast. Okay, so Teresa Morcho is not only a technological genius, she is also the founder and creator of the Stud Model Project, right? We're going to talk a little bit more about that, because what Teresa is doing is paving the way. Today in Hollywood, we're seeing a huge resurgence, or a huge emergence, I think, of the lesbian masculine presenting woman. In the past, it was more so the femme or the feminine woman, right? But we're going to talk a little bit more about that, because the session today is not about that. It's more so the mindset and the strength that it takes for a person to be able to stand out amongst them all, right? So, Teresa, tell us a little bit about yourself. Who are you? Where are you from? Where does the name Morcho come from?
So, I am originally from Cameroon, West Africa.
Okay.
So, I was born in Cameroon in this little town called Douala. And my parents were middle class.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my mother worked for the Cameroonian, the Cameroonian Airlines.
Okay.
And my dad worked for the Cameroonian Embassy, or the American Embassy, rather. So we lived a comfortable life.
A good life, right?
Yeah,
you know, what's funny is that most of the people I've been bringing in here so far, most people didn't come from the, you know, started from the bottom, now I'm here type situation, right?
Right.
So you came already kind of there.
Right. Like, I, you know, the whole public school, private school situation, like, we weren't rich, but we were what we considered upper middle class, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
So around 11 years old, I'm the youngest of five kids. All my brothers had moved to the United States or Europe or whatever. And it was just me and my parents.
Mm-hmm.
So my mom was like, I don't want to be away from my kids.
Mm-hmm.
I want to move to the United States to be with my kids and mm-hmm. be closer. So we all uprooted, and I was like 11 years old. So here I am, this child. And when I tell this story, sometimes I get a little like baffled at mm-hmm. the ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know anything about any of the history of American history as far as like slavery, what was going on, you know. So I'd had a different perspective of myself as a black person.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, like here, most white people, is that their default. Their
mm-hmm.
default
mm-hmm.
is, I'm white. I don't have to care about my race. I don't
right,
have to talk about
right.
race. That was me growing up in Cameroon.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I am a Cameroonian girl. My village is more important to me than my color, my,
mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
my bloodline, my name, Morcho,
mm-hmm.
is more important to me than what my color was.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't until I came here and I was in middle school and I'm like being bullied and, you know, I'm too dark, I'm African booty scratcher, I'm, you know.
So one of the things we talk a lot about is the relationship between African Americans and Africans, right?
Yes, yes.
Did you find that challenging coming up?
It wasn't as challenging for me because I used to travel to the United States often
okay.
as a kid. So I was very comfortable with the African American, you know, culture. I was
okay.
very I was in it. I was comfortable.
Okay.
My mother always made sure we spoke what she considered Oxford English.
Mm-hmm.
So we couldn't even speak pidgin in our own home. Mm-hmm. We had to speak it outside. So mm-hmm. I was comfortable, but I had a very skewed view of what that was until I came. And then I realized
that. Let me ask you this. When you were in Cameroon, what was your perception of African Americans? Did you already have this perception of who we were?
I did.
Yeah, and was it a positive perception? Be honest. I mean,
thing was that we visited both places.
Okay.
We visited my aunt who lived in New Rochelle, New York, upstate,
mm-hmm.
affluent,
mm-hmm.
and we also visited my uncle who lived in like PG County in DC, where like.
Correction, PG County is in Maryland. Okay.
Well,
I'm a DMV girl. Let's get it straight. PG County is in Maryland. Okay. So, for correction purposes.
More so like the Naylor Road area.
Maryland.
Like Maryland. Okay. Right? Naylor Road area, PG County okay. area, where you like you could literally put one foot in Maryland and one foot in DC.
Okay.
So, and then I also saw a different side of that, and mm-hmm. I was like, okay, there's two sides of
there's
America.
There's two sides there's two of America. Sides. Yeah, and it's
but we didn't get that in media.
You know, one of the things...
What we knew was hip-hop.
You knew it was there, right? Yeah. And one of the things I recognized at a very young age from Dr. Seuss, people, humanity, entities, things, beings are going to find a way to separate themselves. Mm-hmm. So if it's not through color, it's religion. If it's not through religion, it's economics. If it's not economics,
yes.
it's...
Yeah.
So in your situation coming from Cameroon, the separation was not color-based, but you came here. It not only was color-based, but it then also was economics.
Yes.
It was an economic difference. Okay, so you're growing up. Would you say you had an easy childhood?
I had a fairly easy childhood until I came here.
Came to Atlanta?
Came to the United States.
To the United States. And yeah. and so, you know,
I was 11 years old.
You were 11. So mm-hmm. 11 was the shock just dealing with the cultural difference, or was it the change in your family dynamics?
Both.
Okay. Let's talk about it a little bit.
Interesting question.
Yeah.
Both. Number one, I'm the last of five kids. So all my brothers and sisters went through school, middle school, high school in Cameroon, where it's very different. It's all about the smarter you are, the more popular you are. Mm-hmm. It's not about what you wear.
And that's different from how I grew up. You know, I grew up on Shell Road, Hampton, VA.
Listen, I didn't know anything about that, mm-hmm. you know? And here I am, first day of seventh grade, and my mom is, like, walking me to the bus stop in, like, a full-grown, like, African, like, mm-hmm. kaba, what we mm-hmm. call kaba, which is, like, an African version of a muumuu.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just like, and she done donned me in this, like, corduroy pants, like Bill Cosby sweater. Mm-hmm. I got Jerry curls in my hair. Like, she was just trying to put me together first day of school. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I am like taunted all day long. And I just remember middle school just being rough because I could not adjust. I didn't.
But what do you think is up now? I mean, there was always bullies, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But now folks are killing you. Back in the day, you may have had a little ruffle, you know, on the bus or whatever, but it was nobody running up in the school killing everybody.
I was a fighter.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I remember being bullied in the eighth grade by two girls at the basketball game. And I fought these two girls. And when I won that fight, a beast came about.
Ah, so then you thought you was the bomb, girl. Don't mess with Teresa.
But I was gone all summer, right? Mm-hmm. And then I didn't hear anything about it because I was like, oh, whatever, you know, mm-hmm. I didn't hear anything mm-hmm. about it. Girl, I came back for ninth grade and it was like, that's her. That's the girl that fought the two girls.
They knew not to mess with you,
so
right?
I became like this, like, yeah, like, don't mess with her. Don't.
Right.
Teresa will whoop your ass. And I took that alter ego mm-hmm, on mm-hmm. to the fullest extent.
And you still live that alter ego?
No, I'm not. I'm a fighter in a different way, man.
Okay. Okay.
I don't put my own belief and put my hands. Because
you're an activist now, right?
I am.
You're an activist.
And that's the thing. I was a fighter, but I was a bully to the bullies because I didn't like being bullied.
So you were like the Robin Hood to the underdog.
Yes.
And you're the Robin Hood now to the underdogs. We want to talk about that a little bit. So that stuff started at a young age.
Yeah.
So let's get to it. When did you find out or determine or express that you were a lesbian?
I came out to my friends in the 10th grade.
Okay.
And I came out to my mom when I was about 17.
Whoa, to an African mom. I know that was interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever come out to your African dad?
He never knew. He passed away not knowing.
Because you know, some places in Africa, it's still against the law. You can be stoned to death. You can be put to death.
Yes.
For being gay.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Did any of those areas of fear ever come across you?
The funny thing about it is I didn't even know that it was a cultural disaster.
Really?
I had no idea.
Okay, so
I was more so fearful of the religious.
So you guys aspect. Were in an extremely religious home.
I was raised Catholic.
Catholic. Yeah. And so what was it that said, I'm gay? Like, how did you know you were gay?
So growing up in Cameroon, I remember having a really, really like intense crush on this girl across the street.
How did you know it was a crush?
It felt different. It was mm-hmm. like, it wasn't like, you know, when my boys came, I was ready to play. Like, I'm ready to go in the lake and jump in the lake and do boy things. Mm-hmm. And the girls were like, oh my God, he's going to do it. I'm like, no, girl, let's go play. But with her, it was like, I would like just come outside my house and just sit and wait for her to go to school. And I would just be like,
do you think she knew?
No, she was way older.
Mm-hmm.
She was more like my brother's age. Mm-hmm. My brother's like 7
So how do you know you just weren't infatuated, like you admired her? How do you know you just wasn't like she was a older girl that you admired?
Like I never spoke to her. My brother had a thing for her, crush for her.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, like I just was just amazed. Like I thought she was just beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
I thought she was like, I don't know. Like I was just like, I just want to like kiss her.
So before you left Cameroon, you knew.
Mm-hmm.
So you came to the
US. I just
US.
Didn't have the language.
You just
it.
Didn't know, right? Mm-hmm. And so did you ever play this role of having a boyfriend at all?
Absolutely.
Okay, so you played that role.
Absolutely.
And then you told your mom at 15?
At 17.
17, okay. So at this point, you had been to the prom and everything.
Yeah.
So was your prom date a guy or a girl?
I had 2 prom dates. I had 2 girls.
Whoa. Okay, so... Did you wear a tuxedo or a dress?
I wore a tux.
So let's back it up, y'all, because you guys see this femme Teresa sitting in front of you, but Teresa hasn't always been femme. Long nails, and all. So you initially entered into the world of the LGBTQ community as a stud. Okay. And for those who do not understand or know what stud means, is a masculine presenting lesbian. Am I correct?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
So if I used any terms incorrectly, please, you guys, count that to the ignorance that I may have.
It's okay. I'll balance her.
Right. So Teresa is teaching me a lot, as well as a few of my other friends, but I just want to make sure, because I don't want anyone to ever think that I'm being disrespectful in any kind of way. So, all right. So at that point, Teresa, you came out the closet.
Yeah.
You told your mom. Your mom decided not to tell your dad.
Right.
Because was she afraid that it was going to?
Well, so at that time, my mom knew my dad was sick. So I lost my father to prostate cancer.
Okay.
Back in 2004. So this was like around 2000 when I came out. And my mom was aware that my dad was sick and had a lot on his plate. Mm-hmm. And my mom is that kind of lady. Like, she protects her children and her family, even to the detriment.
How do you know
herself?
She didn't think you were just going through a phase? You know, back in the day, that's what people say
And I honestly, to that point, I think also she was just like,
she's going through a phase.
Yeah, like, I don't know what, like, my child is bad. Like, I think she felt like, you know, I had five kids. One of them is rotten.
So like, you think that she thought you were rotten?
At that point, yeah. My mother and I had a very, very...
Were you rebellious?
Oh, very.
So she probably thought, okay, very. Teresa's just saying this
and
to
hurt me.
And I was
promiscuous. I was very promiscuous.
Wait a minute, hold on. Promiscuous with who? The guys or the girls?
With guys.
Wait a minute, hold up. I'm confused. Back up. Now, you're promiscuous with the guys, want the girls. Let's talk. How are you... But you know what? Let's back it up, though. I have always... I remember some guys that I always said, too, that I suspected was gay. And that they were very promiscuous with women. And I think they were doing that to cover up. Is that what you... Were you doing that?
Yeah. So...
So you were bully and promiscuous, girl. Yes, tell me about it.
But I was a good student, which is crazy. Like, I kept my grades up. But, like, I would have these, like, encounters with guys, but I could never... emotionally.
Well, could you even enjoy the
No, I kept searching and I just kept, I was like, maybe because he don't know how to do it.
So let me ask you this. It wasn't in your mind that you think, let me keep trying. Maybe I'll find somebody that can change me.
Yeah.
Were you trying to be changed? You think you were trying to change?
I wasn't necessarily even trying to be changed. I was more so like, well, there was a rebellious part of me also that was living up to what my family was thinking of me at that time. Mm-hmm. Because there was a lot that happened around that time. And my family assumed that I was already promiscuous. And I could not tell them that I wasn't. So
no, well, I'm confused, like, though, Teresa. Okay. Mm-hmm. So you were masculine presenting at that time. Mm-hmm. But your family thought you were promiscuous. So who did they think you were going at? Because usually, okay, so.
Well, you know, back then, too, we had the Aaliyahs. Everybody was, I wore Nautica.
Right. That's true.
Yeah,
that's true.
So a lot of people didn't really, like, pick up on it. But I hung around mostly guys. And then some of the guys I hung around with, I slept with. And I thought kind of like the guys in a sense where I was just like, it's just sex.
Well, did they respect you?
Yeah, like that was with my homies. Like we would go to school and be like.
So you would leave that situation and be emotionally unattached?
Completely.
Okay. And so then you realized that, wait a minute, this isn't going to be the thing for me. And then you had this voila experience, right?
So it was like. I was really, again, like you mentioned in the beginning, I was really into computers.
Mm-hmm.
So my downtime when I didn't want to go outside or I would be on AOL or, you know, I'd be on Black Planet or whatever we had. And when I spoke to women, it was a completely different me versus like when I talked to guys. I'm not going to lie. I used to dog men out.
Okay. Teresa was like, breaking hearts, y'all.
I had
and taking names.
I had no emotions to like. I was just like, yeah, whatever, dude. Give me this, give me that, whatever, whatever.
Okay, so you were like me, a gold digger.
I'm a proud.
We need to play a little bit of Kanye, okay? So go ahead.
But that was when I was so young, and I used to be able to get older guys because I my curves came in so early. So that's when my family started to kind of get whims of like, okay, she's out there. And then I hung around nothing but guys. Mm-hmm. So they were like, they knew
what was going on. And so,
That was kind of what my mom was just like, so you've made it through guys. Now you're so promiscuous that you're going into women.
That she probably thought that you had experienced everything with bored and then you were just, you know, going through a phase. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we realize umpteen years later it was not a phase, right?
No.
But how do you go from being a masculine presenting woman to now being super femme to the point your nails are all the way to the South Pole? Well, talk to me a little bit about, I mean, what was that transition like?
What do they call these DGs? We're not going to talk about that. So when I came out to my mother around 17 years old, she was not having it. She was like, you're not going to do that in my house. Not only was I, and perhaps let me let y'all know, my mother and I are like this. Like, I love this woman. Mm-hmm. So, but I have to, sometimes telling your story lets her know that there's still healing to be done in either part, right?
That's right.
So with my mother, it was like, I don't want that done under my roof. You got to get out. I was bag lady girl. Mm-hmm. I had them plastic laundry bags, like them big old ones. And I had like two of them with all my stuff. I was homeless for like 2 weeks.
So let's back up. So it was that important to you to express your sexuality that you were willing to be homeless?
Yes.
Let's talk about that a little bit. Like, why? Why couldn't, she said, not under my roof. So why could you not just live and not actually, because what did she not want you to do under her roof?
She just didn't want, that was the thing, was like, the verbiage to me was that I could not live.
You couldn't be you.
And me not being me is not living.
Right. Right. You felt like you were suffocating.
Options. Like, there were no options for me, because if I lived under her roof, I was going to break her rules.
But you then, later on, you married a man, though.
I did.
So, Teresa, come on now. How we know for a fact that you are sure? You were masculine presenting. You were promiscuous. Yeah. You married a man.
Girl, listen, my life is a book.
Look, you done had an enjoyment, honey.
Yes,
honey, you didn't experience
it. At 17, when I was homeless, like, I didn't know where I was going. I didn't know what I was doing. Like, I had gave up college.
And so you had no mentors or anybody to kind of show you the ropes?
No.
You didn't join a house?
No, not at that time. Because houses back then were really for men. They were really for a lot of the gay men. Women didn't have a lot of places to go back then.
And that's interesting, because I think when we, remember I said earlier on, people will find a way to separate themselves. Yeah. And I was shocked as a heterosexual cisgender woman. I'm correct, right? So as a heterosexual cisgender woman, I was surprised to know the amount of discrimination that goes on within the LGBTQ community between the gay men, the gay women, between trans and gay men or gay women, bisexuals, again, the non-binary, I was really, really surprised. So did you, you think that gay men had had it easier?
I think that they just had a head start just because being a gay black man was way more like against the culture, against the rules. So they had kind of a head start in creating that family dynamic in order to, you know, really support themselves. And then the AIDS epidemic came about in the 80s. So they really had to come together. As far as us with women, especially if you're feminine, you can really hide that. You can hide
it. It seems like most people, especially men are very forgiving about women that are lesbian.
That too.
Right?
That too.
Whereas women are not as forgiving about dating a man who has lived a different life. I think it's changing now in the dynamics that we are. Because a lot of young women today are open to dating bisexual men and so forth, right? But for you, let's talk about that a little bit. So entering into the entertainment industry, did you notice a major difference in the way that you were being received versus some of your gay male counterparts?
Yes, as far as support for my community, just like you mentioned, there's like this divide that happens in our community. And for women, it was harder because, like, I don't know what it was with us, but like this competition thing is real, and no amount
competition
of
between who?
Between women.
That's real. I mean, you know, that's real.
It's real. And there's no amount of masculinity that can cover that.
So in a relationship with two women, you still have, you're battling with that too?
Absolutely.
Really?
Absolutely.
I never even thought about that.
Yeah, my ex-wife and I kind of had that dynamic of like a battle of like this success battle. And it's getting better now in relationships, but I'm saying in women in general, there is this like, you know, I don't know what it is.
It's sickening.
Yeah.
And so let's talk about in the entertainment industry, though, you know, the Me Too movement.
Yeah.
That really started raises its ugly head. And we started to see and hear about a lot of that. I haven't heard a lot of it in the LGBTQ community. So Let's talk a little bit about that. Have you had a lot of experience, or have you had any experience at all with this whole Me Too movement, especially in the space that you're in?
So I have had experience with the Me Too movement with men. As far as women, not so much as far as me being the victim. I have been accused just because I'm a woman in power.
So you've been accused.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So when that happens, it gives you a different perspective because, again, we're two women, right?
Mm-hmm.
And most people, especially when the law is involved, you really how does the law even deal with that?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? How does the law even deal with that? So when you're talking about the Me Too movement, when it's especially with two women, with two men, even two men, the law can't. How? They're going to be like, you're a guy. He's a guy. Why didn't you? Like, they have this perception of, like, because it's two guys, y'all should be able to duke it out.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know? And then they have this perception of, like, if it's two women, you must like it.
Yeah, like.
You know, it's sexualized.
Right.
It's alluring.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not taken seriously. And this happens not just with the Me Too movement of, like, sexual assault, but with abuse. It happens. Mm. With domestic abuse and relationships.
Yeah, because I think, I wonder how the cops handle that, really,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
What do you think about what's happening now with Brittney over in Russia? Do you think that if she were Michael Jordan Absolutely. Or somebody else, that they would treat her differently?
Yes. 120% yes. She does not fit the look of what the entertainment industry is looking to push forward when they're fighting for a cause. She just doesn't fit that.
Even though the LGBTQ community is so strong right now. She's black and she's a woman, right?
She's black and she's a masculine presenting queer person.
So you think they're trying to sweep her under the rug? What do you think is going on?
Because
an activist, how come you haven't raised the roof? What's going on?
So we have actually been talking about it under the table, but there's something very unique about this situation just because it is so heavily politicized. Like
I don't understand. Like I'm really trying to figure it out. Like why is nobody talking about it? The wife, she's married, right? Yeah. The wife isn't even really raising the roof. It's as if somebody has put a gag order.
Yeah.
What's going on, Teresa?
And that's what I don't understand. Like, when we talk about it in our little panel of discussions,
mm-hmm.
it's almost like we have all these things that we want to push and do, but then we're like, what is the trickle effects of this?
Mm-hmm.
Like, how does this impact the bigger global?
Well, how does it impact?
War?
Why haven't you, as one of the most respected African-American female activists,
mm-hmm.
lesbian activists,
mm-hmm.
why haven't you and some others, Teresa Morchos, joined hands? You have me as a media contact. Why hasn't there been more outrage to bring this young woman home?
Let's do it. The reason I say that is because, again, that's kind of what, when it happened initially, we were outraged. There was like constant posting, but then that's social media, right?
Social media is living a fake life.
That's what I'm
right?
saying. Like, that's in social media. As far as what are we doing boots on the ground, so mm-hmm. to speak, as the military will mm-hmm. say, what are we doing boots on mm-hmm. the ground? And nothing, and I openly will say nothing is being done, even on my end.
If it was Ellen DeGeneres, would that still be the case?
Listen,
would
girl.
It? Because
if
from
it was
my understanding.
Ellen DeGeneres, listen, the White House would be split in two.
Why is it Kamala and Biden doing something about it? Let's be real about it. Why?
I'm telling you right now, and every time I talk about the intersectionality of a masculine presenting black queer person, people don't understand. Just because it's Brittney Griner and she has this huge name in basketball does not negate the fact that she is still fitting in this very small demographic of a person that was born assigned. If I'm not correct, y'all will correct me.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Brittney Griner is non-binary. And so,
okay, so you know you're going to have to school me on this because I hear a lot of people. So you're trying to say that she was born a woman.
I think we'll say she for context here, but I think she
out of respect.
Out of respect, I think she goes by they, them.
They. So they was. I'm using the wrong.
Yeah, it's.
So
it's a Brittney. Been a while, so, don't feel bad.
So Brittney was born a woman, but she does not classify herself as such or as a man anymore either, right?
Correct. From what I last read and understood.
Okay.
So,
okay.
But for context, like I said, just, you know, to keep the conversation. And, and again, I know these topics are very sensitive, so I don't want
to. No disrespect to anybody. Right. We're just trying to bring awareness to a situation.
With what's going on with Brittney, is like, number one, female, black, queer, masculine presenting. These are all the bottom totem pole of these demographics that we're talking about. Even in the LGBTQ community, the black queer woman is like the last person to be represented in a lot of the things that we show. Unless she's powerful, unless she brings about change, you know? And so when we're talking about Brittney Griner, it's like, we are here to make that change, but we ourselves are separated. We're like this. So Stud Model Project, even when we talk about what I do, is to bring that closer. What we hear as a stud, as a stem, what we hear as a transgender, what we hear as all these different labels, at the end of the day, we're all masculine presenting people who are assigned female at birth and who are black. And we share a very similar experience. And if we don't come together on that, on a global scale, things like this with Brittney Griner will get missed completely because the trans community will feel like it's not my fight.
How did you become an activist?
Because I needed one.
You didn't have one. You needed someone to speak up for you, right?
I needed one desperately.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then why the Stud Model Project when you're not a stud?
It was kind of my way of like honoring that masculine part of me that I let go because I let go of that person to survive, you know, to survive in society. And I let go of that person so much that I didn't recognize that person anymore.
So you, and so you're saying internally you're still a stud.
Yeah.
But you present as a femme to be accepted. Oh, okay. So how do you think the women in the project feel about that?
There is a connection that happens when I speak to them because I don't, my conversation with my models are never a y'all. It's always a we.
But do they see you as a we?
Yeah. We're, because the dynamic for us is family first. Like, they call me boss lady, but to me, I'm like big sister. I'm like, yeah, I have a dominant personality for sure, but I'm very nurturing, caring, feminine, all of those things. But when I'm with them, I don't see myself any different. And I don't think they see me any different outside of the fact that.
Because after a while, you no longer look at a person, you start to connect with their, spirit,
energy.
Right? Their energy.
Correct.
So let's talk about your IVF journey, right? So you want to become a mom, right?
I do.
So let's talk about that. How difficult has that been so far?
It has been probably the hardest thing I have ever done in my entire life.
Wow.
It is by far the most taxing thing I've ever done in my entire life.
But you want a baby that bad, right?
Yeah.
You're about to get married, are you?
Yeah, well, I am engaged.
Oh, engaged. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
You seem extremely happy on Facebook. Is this marriage 1, 2, 3? Which marriage is this, Teresa?
I am shy. This is officially marriage 2.5.
I'll say. Okay, no, come on now. 2.5.
I'll say 2.5.
Is it? Were you okay?
Because my ex dude wasn't. That was like an arranged thing.
You
like,
still got to claim like, him though, right? He was there.
He was there on paper. Yeah,
he was not there. So
he was there.
So this is marriage number 3. So you think three times a charm?
She ain't going nowhere. She ain't got no choice. I like.
But
I
who normally? The question is, Teresa. I have a feeling that you the one who drop him off at the corner and keep on going. Now, how do you know that you are going to really be able to settle it down this time? You're the heartbreaker over there, girl.
I had to clutch my pearls with that one. So she's aware that I'm an Aquarius.
Okay.
And we do have, our cutoff game is strong.
I mean, I could just tell Teresa that you are playing no games. Some of the stuff that you play, post on Facebook, I mean, you don't care.
No. Mm-hmm. No, not at all. My cutoff game is strong. And so but she's aware that, and I told her this, I said, for me, marriage is not about me telling you that I want to spend the rest of my life with you. Mm-hmm. That's not marriage for me. Mm-hmm. For me, marriage is me waking up and saying, I'm going to try to make this right here the most beautiful experience.
The moment that we're in right now.
The moment that we're in.
I can't promise you forever. I can't promise you forever. I got you. So, you know, something I saw that you posted, it was probably about a year ago. You posted something that stated that you have different beliefs in spirituality. So you were born a Catholic.
Yes.
How do you identify yourself today?
Godly.
Okay. And what does that mean? What does that mean?
So there was one point in my life where, and that's kind of how I ended up married. When I lost my dad in the military, I lost my father, and I was like, maybe he's gone because God is cursing me for being gay and being this and that and that. So I was in church a lot, and I actually met my ex dude in the military base that I was in. And so that right there was kind of like my spiritual journey to Christianity, away from Catholic, but more of a general Christian sense. And when I lost my daughter, I lost my daughter at 18 weeks pregnant. Mm. I gave birth to her, and she died in my arms. Oh, right?
I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, so that was like a surreal experience. Mm-hmm. It was very surreal, and I was alone. Like, her father and I had so much issues. So when I gave my life to God, no one was around. There was no Bible around. There was no pastor, no priest, no no church lady, no cross, no nothing. Mm-hmm. I was literally in the bathroom taking a shower, and I went to, like, rub myself down in milk, you know, like, because my body is thinking there's a baby. Mm-hmm. Feed the baby. And I went like this, and the milk came out, and I lost my mind and was about to lose my life that day. And it was that day that I gave my life to God. So what I realized was that my search for God was an internal search. It was never external. Mm-hmm. Because every time that I went outside searching for God, when I went to people, when I went to churches, when I went to books and Bibles and all of that, I found everybody else's version of God versus my own. So my connection to spirituality and to God is very organic. It doesn't have a religious tint to it. Mm-hmm. It's just very organic. Do I read the Bible? Do I find the Bible useful? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But I'm not the one who says that this book is better than this book, is more truthful than this book, than that book. Mm-hmm. My spirituality to God is just really organic. It's more so like listening to that. When you meditate, listening to that voice, like, am I thinking thoughts or are thoughts thinking me?
Right.
You know?
And mental health, right? Do you think that has a lot to do with the mental health challenges that a lot of LGBTQ individuals go through? Because, I mean, not only just that, I'm noticing today, Teresa, suicide is at an all-time high. I mean, every time I turn on my Instagram, it's like a spirit of death that's taking over. And they're young people. And I'm like, whoa. And then the way that they're doing it, it's not even, it's a very painful way, jumping off the buildings and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. Do you think that it's a lot of it has to do with societal perceptions, us having to live up to one another's expectations, Instagram, TikTok? Yes. What do you think about it?
And I'm not even going to lie. There are times when I wake up in the morning and I feel amazing. I'm like, I can take over the world. Mm-hmm. And then there's some times that I wake up in the morning and I'm like, I have to do another possibly 40 or 50 years of this shit.
Oh, man. You know, Teresa, I've never woke up feeling that way.
Yeah. That's depression.
So you would say that you are a functioning depressant?
Absolutely.
Really?
Yeah.
And
I have Monday therapy every week.
So what do you think is the contributing factor to that? Have you guys been able
to
dig into that?
I've had a lot of trauma in my life. Mm-hmm. I've experienced a lot of loss and a lot of trauma and lack of support, lack of understanding how to maneuver through that, how to deal with that. Mm-hmm. And luckily, my spirituality is my base. Mm-hmm. And when people lose that, unfortunately, people connect spirituality to religion so hard that when they lose religion, they lose spirituality. Mm-hmm. And that is when things fall apart. Things completely fall apart. So for me, I just was like, this is not how I want to be. I don't want to see the world in this way because I have so many great things going on. But your mind gets
your mind's playing tricks on you, right?
It gets really clouded. Like, there's some people, and I tell people, don't measure your depression with me. Mm-hmm. Because there's some people who can lose their entire family in a house fire and, like, be burnt from one side and live a completely happy, beautiful, skydiving, rock climbing, joyful marriage with children. And then there's some people who will lose their dog. And that's it for them. Mm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it is a chemical imbalance as well. And I want people to understand that depression is not just, oh, because I had a lot of trauma as well. There is like a chemical imbalance that happens when your stress hormones are triggered over and over and over and over and over and over and over again, that your brain automatically just says stress before any other solution can be thought about. Mm-hmm. It's like your brain goes there first. And once it's there, if you don't have those mechanisms to get you off that ledge, it's tough.
That explains. I mean, because I think when I see the youth and I see folks talking about their trauma, like even when I hear when I talk to some folks I went to high school with, a lot of them are saying that high school was the worst years of their life. And it was like, I loved high school. So I
did. Were you the popular girl?
I enjoyed high school. Yeah. I was, you know, well known, and I did not have a negative experience in my youth.
Yeah.
And what I'm finding is I don't think that people realize that what they do to children today impacts them for the rest of their life.
Ever.
Lack of support, you know, too much abuse, harsh words, you know, inappropriate touches, you know, constantly questioning their worth. And you wonder why these folks grow up and they are trying to figure it out, Teresa.
And to be honest, right, I tell people not just your childhood trauma, but what you do when you're an adult and the person that gave you that childhood trauma, how you deal with them can also impact. Because I say that to say, like, my mother just left from here 2-3 weeks ago. And for the first time in a long time, I was able to look at my mother as, like, she was telling me stories about things that were going on, you know, when I was going through some of the things, that we really had a woman-to-woman conversation. And for the first time, you see your mother as a woman first. You see her as a person first. Mm-hmm. And then you see her as a wife before you see her as a mother. And then so I started to kind of like remember some of the things that were going on in my head when my mother was kind of dealing with me the way she was dealing with me. And I had to make sense of that because I am a woman now trying to be a mother. And I have made so many mistakes.
We all have. Teresa, I mean, we all have. Don't be. Girl.
I have made so many mistakes. And I don't know how that impacts my nieces, my nephews, let alone a child that I'm raising.
One of my biggest fears is I pray every night that I have not done anything that can destroy or deter my children. I mean, that would do something to me to know that I work overtime to make sure that my kids are happy. Because that would do something to me, right?
Yeah.
It really would.
Especially if you're not aware.
If you're not aware. You know what I mean? But then I think it's some people who are aware of their damaging ways and just don't care. They look for people they consider to be weaker than them.
Yeah.
And they, you know, do horrible things. Yeah. But let's talk about how you were able to turn that pain, that depression, into a thriving business, right? Because that's what Coinology is all about. It's about the mindset of the winners. Most people always say, I want to be Teresa. I want to be Gabrielle Union. I want to be Oprah. I want to be, but they don't know the sacrifices and the experiences that one had to go through and the sacrifices one had to make so that you can be a Teresa Morcho, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So how are you able to turn that pain into a thriving business?
So creativity has always been therapeutic mm-hmm. for me. I always enjoy painting and things of that nature. So when I lost my daughter, Genesis, I kind of got back into my creative side mm-hmm. and to be sane.
Mm-hmm.
I got out of the military, I think was, 2009, around the time when, you know, economic collapse was happening, mm-hmm. recession was happening. I couldn't find work. I couldn't find a job. I was losing my house to the mortgage disaster that was happening at that time.
That 2008 disaster. Yeah.
So I was part of that, and I, you know, lost my house. And being in that situation, I was just like, "What do I do?
Mm-hmm.
I can either lay down and be homeless again, which that will never happen,
mm-hmm.
or I can lace my boots up and make something happen."
Mm-hmm.
So I created Trebor Entertainment, which was just an entertainment company, and Trebor Graphics simultaneously.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a graphics designer. I started doing flyers. I taught myself how to do flyers mm-hmm. and all of that stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's just kind of how I started my business. Mm-hmm.
But you were hungry.
I was hungry. And mm-hmm. I needed to survive. Mm-hmm. Like, survival mode will make or break you.
Mm-hmm.
So you can either lay down and... Or I can dig in at all my resources that I've learned over the years and make something happen for that.
What I heard from you, or did not hear from you, that I think is synonymous or repetitive with winners, is that they don't look for other people to blame. You never sat back and said, my mom didn't do this, my dad didn't do this, my ex-husband didn't do this, my da-da-da. You said, I need to do this.
Yeah.
Right. And I think that's important for people to know, is that you didn't look externally for somebody to come in and save you. Yeah. You said, I'm going to save myself.
Yeah.
Right. I'm putting the trauma behind me. I am not going to be in that position again. So something clicked in your head.
Yeah.
And that click is the click that the top 10% have.
Wow. I didn't know that.
Yeah. The majority of people will do the woe is me. Someone did me wrong. You don't get me. You need to give me this. The system owes me that. They would just spend most of their time saying someone owes them, instead of taking that energy and saying, what can I do to solve my problem? And the top 10% are the ones who think like that.
Yeah.
And that is the reason why you're here with Coinology right now, right?
Wow. That's intense. I never thought about that.
Mm-hmm.
I've never, because my thought process has always been, Teresa, you got to get yourself into it or get yourself out of it.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? If I, and not to say that I don't have a supporting team to push me there, but with or without that team, baby, this choo-choo train
mm-hmm,
moving,
mm-hmm.
you know? So that's one of the things that I just, and I've, even when I quit on myself, even when things happen that are bad or I fail in something, like, It is always a learning experience.
Failing is part of success. Always. You have to fail forward. Always. You have to fail to get to the finish line. And, you know, I would say this too, Teresa. It's not about failing, because we all have to do it. It's how you fail. Mm-hmm. And what I will say is, the time that I've known you and every time I've had interactions with you, you've always been pleasant. Man. That in itself is going to take you a very long way. You know, when people like dealing with you, they're going to care about your success and they're going to remember you. That is why when we were saying, okay, who do we want as part of season one corner? That is how the names come up. You think about it, you know?
I was so excited.
That's how because it's you leave a memorable mark. And even through the trauma and the trials and tribulations, you don't put that on other people. You leave them feeling better than you did when you met them. That's important. That's what I think. Real leaders leave people feeling good.
I really appreciate that, because times get hard sometimes, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And sometimes when you're that person, it's like, who do you go to when you're that person? Mm-hmm. But one thing I've noticed in life is that, and one of my really good friends, Tamika, if you're watching this, baby, I love you. one of my really good friends, you know, we sit down all the time and we have this conversation. She's like, sometimes people are going through things too.
Everybody. That's what, so let's back up. Everybody going through something,
put
right?
That on YouTube.
So that's the part I'm saying. So people think they the only ones going through something and everybody's supposed to give just them grace. But what about us?
Yes.
We're all going through something, right?
And the people like us who, and I'm not downgrading anybody, but right. The people who put themselves out there are usually the people who go through the most.
And they go through it alone. You know, because no one checks on that strong friend.
Yes.
Right? Yes. And that's the part that I think is important, is that all of us recognize that everybody is going through something in this journey called life.
Yeah.
And we need to respect that. We need to honor it. We also need to respect that everybody's different, because everybody isn't as strong as the others.
Absolutely.
So when you recognize that, you handle and deal with everyone differently. So we're not saying that everybody can handle the same things that Teresa can handle.
And that's why I said that before, right? You can't judge someone else's because some people can deal with a lot and some people just can't.
But, you know, Teresa, so as we bring Coinology to a close, what is it that you see for the Stud Model Project moving forward in the future? What do you see the purpose of this? So what's the purpose? What's the purpose, and what do you see happening with this movement?
I am so excited. Like, this question makes me giddy because a lot of things has been happening ever since we met. Mm-hmm. And I just love you guys so much for all the support that you guys have poured into me and the project, even not understanding truly where, because, honey, I didn't even understand where I was going. Mm-hmm. I just knew, like, I had one vision. And that vision has already come to play. I didn't do it, but that's how you know that what you're thinking about is bigger than you when you're happy, even when someone else does it.
Okay.
Because the purpose.
The purpose is happening. It doesn't matter who owns it.
Exactly.
Right.
So for me, I remember starting this project. I said, I just want to see a stud on Times Square in like a Calvin Klein underwear, like dressed like the boy version kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And I've seen that already. It's happened. Different bodies have happened. And I was just like, okay, so where do we go next? So for us, it's like, I want to bring a collective together globally, not just in the United States of America, but globally. We have so many studs and masculine presenting people that were, you know, we say AFAB in Africa.
What does AFAB mean?
Assigned female at birth.
Okay.
Yeah. So we have so many of them in South Africa, Kenya, Nigeria. We have them in Jamaica. There's so many of them. But they're also in places where, just like you said earlier, they can't be themselves freely. Mm-hmm. So number one, we want to touch those people. We want to bring them in, because Stud Model Project is very therapeutic, and it gives these groups of people a place to go to fellowship, to gain confidence, and to just be creative and to network with each other. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we're a photo kind of you know, but we're also creating this environment for them to be able to just exist.
It's educational too.
It's educational too.
Because one of the things I'll say, ever since I met you, I started paying more attention. Yeah. And I don't know if this is new, but I've noticed that now that most of the top rated movies that are out now all have a masculine presenting woman in lead roles now, right? Has that always?
No.
So this is just, cause I was like, okay, am I just now seeing this because Teresa, so your time is now, right? Yes. So this is new. How do you guys feel when you see that? Like, I know you were probably celebrating.
Oh man. Listen, some of these roles, I commend Lena Waithe and some of the other pioneers that came before her who have created this platform. But Lena Waithe, I think, was like the cherry on top because she came into a position of not just an actor or actress. She came into a position as a writer, producer, creator, where she actually created her own genre where she can pick and choose who she wants to put in these lead roles. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And when people actually started to see that, and not just in lead roles where they're criminals. We've seen
like
those,
Set It Off, you think?
Exactly. Right. Set It Off and but, The Wire but, and
so
stuff
how did,
like that.
The Wire, that's right.
Yeah.
That is true. Most of the, I didn't think about that before.
Yeah, if you, what's the other one, Pimp?
I didn't even think about
that.
So they're
usually criminals or some kind of like.
Right.
But recently, we're starting to see like, you know, Harlem where she was like this tech guru geek. You know, they're like these. I'm like, okay.
Harlem. And there was another movie that was, because I inboxed you. I saw it on Netflix and I was like, hey, I can't remember the name.
I think it was Bruce. Was it Bruce?
I can't remember now.
With Halle Berry?
Yes. Yeah. With Halle Berry, right? Yeah. That's when I first noticed. I said, wait a minute, Teresa, I think your movement is making some noise out here, right? Yeah. And I saw and I was like, wow, I know Teresa and her community. They're extremely proud. Yeah.
Very.
Yeah. It takes a real trailblazer and a real leader to be able to go in the midst of noise and still keep going and keep your head up. I want to be able to say, I want to honor you.
Thank you.
Because, you know, a lot of times we wait until the person is no longer here and things of that nature. Yeah. But I think that you're brilliant. I think that you're smart. I think you're courageous. And I am proud to say from a sister to sister that I know you, that we've crossed paths. And I continue to root for you. I watch you. You share your story. You're really transparent. You're sharing your IVF struggles. You're sharing your walk with your interracial fiance. Yeah.
You share, that in itself is a walk.
Yep. You share your spirituality thoughts. Yeah. You're very, very transparent. And I don't know if you realize that when you write, people listen. I'm sure you do because on TikTok, your stuff has gone viral a gazillion times, right?
Yeah, my page is now private on TikTok, but when it was public.
Now, private. Why are you private?
So it's private.
I mean, you went viral a million times.
So I can only handle one viral account, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Stem Model Project started to go viral.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I need somebody to either handle one of these accounts.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, let me kind of pull myself back a little bit, especially because, you know, I was going through the whole IVF and I had surgery and all of that stuff. So I just kind of pulled my community a little bit closer to me.
Okay.
With my Teresa Morcho.
Mm-hmm.
But Stud Model Project has just been, man, we just did this whole thing with Slutty Vegan. I was just like,
I saw that. Big ups to that, girl. How did that happen with you and Pinky? How did that happen?
I have been sliding into many, many DMs. Where the camera at?
I've
been sliding into y'all DMs. Mm-hmm. But I've been sliding into a lot of brands, especially brands here in Atlanta, to just collaborate with them. And so I have been hitting up Pinky. I've been hitting up Kaleidoscope. I'm plugging.
Okay, Judy.
Right. And I've just been hitting
Well, you
them
know,
up.
Brett. So, Brett exactly. would, you know, and I know Brett's going to see this. Brett, you need to hit my girl Teresa up. And Brett reps
the community.
The community.
I mean, like, she is literally the staple of what most.
You know what? We got to talk about that before we close out.
Yes.
What do you think about? I mean, now it's, you know, Niecy Nash and Jessica Betts.
Yeah.
Brad and Judy, what has that done for your community?
I mean, we just feel like we can bag them now.
Okay. Yeah, because if you think about it, hold on. Judy,
I'm not being disrespectful,
no, you're right,
you know,
though,
I mean?
Because like, Judy was not a lesbian. She still doesn't classify herself as a lesbian, right?
Right.
And Niecy was also, I think, just as of late, she may have, but before, when people asked her, was she gay, she said, no, she was just living, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, so that's two studs that were able to get long-term heterosexual. So let me ask this. I think that's right. I'm glad because I told Fonz I was going to ask this question. And Fonz almost let me forget asking it. Do you think everybody is gay? And that, because you know, I remember one time I watched a thing on Oprah Winfrey years ago, and Oprah said that there's a gay-o-meter. And some people are just more gay than others.
I think all of those facets are fluid. Gender, expression, sexuality. I think all of them are fluid.
So you think that's how a 50-year-old, because Niecy was 50 when she married Jessica Betts.
Mm-hmm.
That's how a 50-year-old heterosexual, two-time married mother could go all the way in.
Mm-hmm. Because I think that there are more people in the closet than there are people out. Just because society says that you're supposed to be, for a long time, society says a man is supposed to be with a woman, and that's how.
So you think it was a closet situation? You don't think that it was just we met?
And when I say closet, I don't mean that in a, like, she even knew. She may not have even known.
Mm-hmm.
But some people just don't even look at that because society says that if you're a woman, you're supposed to deal with a man. So they don't even think of that as an option.
Well, you know, what's odd to me is when I see, and this is just my ignorance as a heterosexual cisgender woman. When I see Jessica and Niecy, I see the relationship. When I see Judy and Brett, I see the relationship, but I see they're like best friends. I see them as girlfriends. Like, they seem like they chill out like me
I
and my girls
with,
chill.
With Niecy and
really?
Jessica.
I see that more. So I see their relationship being more like my husband and I. Like, it just seems different. Judy and Brett just seem like really good best friend girlfriends. Not
Brett, too, is more on what we would call the androgynous or STEM.
Yeah, because sometimes when I see her, I mean, Brad is beautiful, drop dead, gorgeous.
But she has stud energy.
She has stud, always have, even when she was with Allen Iverson. Sorry, you never fooled me, but she's always been drop dead gorgeous. Yes. And so when I see her get dressed up, I'm like, wow, Brad is killing him.
And she thick. I'm sorry.
Okay, so you...
But that was the boy in me.
But when I see Brett and Judy, I just see good girlfriends.
Yeah, I see their love. Like, I see.
I mean, I see they love each other.
Like,
yeah, definitely.
That, but like for me and my, and that's why I say when people ask me if I'm stud inside, like me and my girlfriend or my fiance rather, like we stupid. If there was a camera, y'all would probably be like, "What are they homies? Like, what's happening?" But like that's the beauty of it.
What
you
does
know, you get a best friend?
You get a best. I mean, yeah. And the thing is, sometimes I remember one shot. Brett showed she had dressed up in Judy's dress or something. It was maybe a year ago.
And she was like,
yeah. And Judy wasn't there. She did a photo shoot in Judy's dress, and Brett was dressed all up. She looked really, really, really nice. But it's like, yeah, they could even wear each other's clothes and everything. It's a trip because I was saying, wow, they look like best friends. Their relationship seems like they just sit back and just talk about the same
stuff.
Right.
You just
I'll often wonder. I was like, I wonder, because I know both of their relationships at the same time that Brad and Judy got married, Niecy and Jessica were on the cover of Essence.
Mm-hmm.
What did that mean? What did that mean to your community?
I'm not even going to lie to y'all. I shed a tear. First of all, because I've been following Jessica.
I didn't know who she was.
What? I have been on Jessica for over 10 years.
Really?
Now. Yes. Like, I have messages going back and forth with her when I even wanted to work with her.
Mm-hmm.
probably 8+ years ago when okay. she was, you know, heavy in her music. Mm-hmm.
I heard she's a phenomenal artist.
Phenomenal artist. Beautiful voice. Mm-hmm. And I just remember seeing that cover, and I was just like, y'all gonna learn today.
I think they learn.
Excuse me for the echo, but they gonna learn today.
I
said, because you cannot deny that is a beautiful couple.
When you see Niecy and Jessica, you see this amount of love between yes. the two of them.
It looks just authentic, normal, organic. It doesn't look like what America has been telling people, you know, these bulldaggers mm-hmm, look mm-hmm, like mm-hmm. and are doing. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't look like that. It doesn't.
And I think the other part about it, too, is that Niecy's not apologizing no. for it. She just says, this is me.
At all. I love her for that.
And, you know, and for her to be the age that she is and the age that she came out, she's extremely confident.
Yeah. And there's another actress who just came out as bisexual. Oh, I cannot think of her name now. But she has done a lot of kind of like that B-list movies. Actually, some Tyler Perry movies as well.
I think I know who you're talking about.
I cannot think of her name to save my life. But she just came out as well and was very unapologetic about it. And I was just like, you know what? Kudos to you.
But, you know, and this is my last question. I know it's going to go a little bit, but Afonso is going to get me. But the question I have is, okay, so what makes you gay? How does she know that she's just not having an enjoyable sexual experience? Like,
who? So I will flip that question. Okay. Right? And I've flipped this question before and mm-hmm. asked straight people.
Okay.
How do you know that you're straight?
Because I have no I'm not attracted to a woman. I'm not interested in a woman.
So how, and men ask these questions all the time, mm-hmm. right? So how do you know you haven't met the right one, the right woman?
I just don't have it. I don't think there's a right woman for me.
Now that is a solid question. Mm-hmm. And so that's where you fit on that spectrum. Mm-hmm. But then there's some people.
So I'm all the way over here on this side of this. Fonz, I'm over here. Okay. Y'all better recognize. Okay.
You all the way over here.
I try to tell LaShondra that too. LaShondra, I'm over here.
See, for me, like, let's say lesbian is here.
Okay.
I am like right here.
So you have a little space
and
over there?
And the reason I have space is because I'm overly attracted to masculinity.
Of course, if you were out there
so
getting your groove girl, you a little bit over here.
No.
So that is why, because I often wonder, and then someone explained to me when I said, so why would a woman go and get with a stud when they can just go down the street and get with Quincy?
Yeah.
But I recognize that it's not just the sexual piece. It's a connection that women understand women differently, treat them differently, cater to them differently. And Quincy just isn't equipped to do that.
Yeah.
Right?
Like, there is nothing in me. Now, and the reason also I say I'm here is mm-hmm. because, baby, if Method Man ever walked in through my door, I might lose my whole entire. Child.
Idris Elba, how about him? See, no?
Because I have, and that's because I have that one. Idris Elba is a little.
Really?
No.
Girl, what? No, you know. Yeah, you are definitely a lesbian. Anytime you say, girl, yes. Idris, you definitely.
You can have him.
Girl. So the only guy that you really have a real crush on is Method Man?
That's it. On this whole entire planet.
Really?
Yes. That's it.
Method.
That's it.
You're turning him out, Method.
So it was like, but I'm really attracted to masculinity. Okay. And I think I'm attracted to Method Man because like there's like some hyper masculinity.
The swag is real with Method. It's weird. You know, Wu-Tang. Okay, let's back up. What you know about, before we close out, are you a hip hopper?
I am.
When did you fall in love with hip hop?
I actually fell in love with, when did I fall in love with hip hop? It wasn't, it probably was Wu-Tang.
What about MC Light?
I was grown, but I wasn't.
Really?
I was still listening to like Michael Jackson and stuff like that back in the day.
What about Latifah?
Not like that. It wasn't until I really got into like, I actually got into E-40 and all of that before I got into
that. Okay. Wu-Tang. Okay. So that's true. So you, because you're up in a DMV area. So DMV, Biggie?
Yeah.
Tupac?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Bone Thugs and Harmony.
Okay, okay, yeah. Okay, okay. Yeah. And then we got to show the West Coast a little bit of love, too.
Yeah.
Eazy-E.
Eazy-E.
Snoop.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. All right. So you got a little hip hop up in you, girl. I would have said you was a neo soul, but you got a little hip.
I'm neo soul now.
Yeah, you're very neo. Now. You're very Erykah Badu-ish. Okay.
I'm also bald head ho shit now.
Okay.
I'm a lot of.
Well, y'all, I have enjoyed. Oh, sweet girl. What about Lizzo?
I love me some Lizzo.
Lizzo letting y'all.
I love me some Lizzo. Her show was off the chain. I have Amazon Prime.
Oh, I gotta watch it. Lizzo ain't playing no games with y'all.
I love Lizzo.
Oof. Lizzo said you gonna take and get all of me.
I just wanna be her best friend.
You wanna be her best friend?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just feel like she just that bitch. You know what I mean?
Lizzo don't care
at all.
And that's, I think, true. But she's a trailblazer.
Yeah.
She's one of those top 10% that I think in 20 years, there's going to be a discussion about how she opened the door for larger women to have a conversation about sexuality and the perceptions of society.
And what is considered sexy and
beautiful. Acceptable.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's going to be the person that we end up talking about later on in life. She's a trailblazer. Whether you like her or not.
And the amount of effort she has taken to keep her relationship private, you need to write a book about that.
Yeah,
Lizzo,
well, I'm with Lizzo. You keep your business, you know, all that on social media. You asking for people to come in and destroy.
This is true.
But you know what? We enjoy you today, Teresa. Thank you so much for coming in, being always welcoming and transparent and open to share.
Good conversation.
Oh, yeah. And with good people and good lemon drops, right? Hey, and we'll see you guys next time on Coinology. Welcome to Coinology, the podcast.